Let's see. Welcome to my presentation on Eclector, a portable and extensible implementation of the Common Lisp Reader algorithm. In this presentation, I would like to introduce and demonstrate the Eclector project, mainly from a user's perspective. To do this, I will start with the introduction of the project and a little bit of history regarding it. The main part of the presentation will focus on features that set Eclector apart compared to other Common Lisp readers, in particular errors and error recovery, customization possibilities for ordinary reader features, handling of skipped input, as well as lower level entry points. The final discussed feature will be path results. All features are illustrated with small demos or applications. The presentation will conclude with a discussion of performance considerations as well as current problems and several possibilities for future work. Let's begin with the introduction. So first of all, what is the Common Lisp Reader? It is not a single concept or even object in the technical sense, but it's rather a loose collection of things that are described in chapter 2 of the Common Lisp specification. Namely, on the conceptual level, there are characters and syntax types of characters, the read table, several variables that also influence the behavior of the reader. There's a description of the reader algorithm itself in chapter 2. Part of this is the description of token interpretation. Both of those are mostly on the conceptual level, and the described concepts are largely not represented technically. And finally, there are standard reader macros, which are described in terms of their syntax as well as their behavior. But as we will see on the technical side, starting here, the reader macros themselves are more or less opaque. It's possible to install a given reader macro for a character or define new reader macros, but it is not envisioned, apparently, for example, to invoke the reader macros using a standardized function name like one would invoke ordinary functions. Similarly, going back to the category of characters and syntax types, there is set syntax from character, which allows copying the syntax from one character to another, but the syntax itself is not represented explicitly. Regarding the read table and other aspects of the reader behavior, this is basically the most customizable part of the reader. But the customization is done by changing predefined facets of the reader's behavior by setting values for the standardized variables. It is not possible to define new behavior using these variables. Then there's the reader algorithm, to which only high-level entry points like read or read preserving whitespace are provided. But the parts of the reader algorithm that are described in the specification, in particular token interpretation and the skipping of whitespace, are internal to each implementation and cannot be accessed by portable programs beyond being included in these high-level reader functions. One possible exception would be the parse integer function, but this does not belong to chapter 2, so not technically part of the reader, but it belongs to the numbers section of the specification. And one of the goals of Eclector is to make more of these aspects extensible and available to conforming programs without using implementation internals. So, in summary, some aspects of the reader are customizable through standard means, but not all. And similarly, parts of the reader algorithm are also not available. Now, a brief history of the project. The Eclector project didn't start under the name Eclector. It was more or less just the reader for Robert's Sickle project. And I suppose the old goal was to make a conforming reader implementation. But Robert extracted the code from the Sickle project and chose a separate name. And at that point, the new goal was to make a portable and extensible implementation of the reader algorithm. Somewhere at that point, I took over maintaining the project and also development, and completed the conforming reader implementation goal, mostly to my knowledge. I should probably qualify that. But my main work was on the extensibility and other features that are not necessarily part of a conforming reader implementation. Okay, so for this part, I'm recording this presentation for the third time now for technical reasons, so I can't really attempt again to make the joke. So you can just read it, and then I will reveal the actual reason behind the name. Okay, so I don't know, you maybe know this, the rule for Robert's project is that CL has to be in the name, and also there has to be a pun, or mainly a pun, and also something actually related to the purpose of the project. So there you go. So to make the goals explicit one more time, the current goal is to create an implementation of the Common Lisp Reader algorithm that didn't change, but which of course has to conform to the specification. But in addition to that, the implementation should provide excellent and translatable error messages for all possible syntax errors. It should be able to recover from all, or ideally all, but at least most possible syntax errors. The implementation should provide protocols and thus be highly extensible and customizable. It should also allow source location tracking when reading, mainly when reading code, and it should correspondingly allow path result construction. And finally, it should also achieve acceptable performance for most clients and use cases. At this point, there could be exceptions. For example, if a client wants to read huge amounts of numeric data, that may be out of scope for Eclector. It focuses more on the source code reading side. One thing that is not in scope for Eclector is loading, as in the Common Lisp function load, an entire file, because that involves other things such as tracking the current package and evaluating code at read time. So that's out of scope for a Common Lisp reader. Now a little bit more about the project itself. So we are, of course, implementing a specification, which is always nice. But even our favorite specification isn't perfect. For example, could you tell which of the following examples are valid according to the Common Lisp specification? what you see here is what Eclector thinks. So for this structure literal, it says the proper list has to immediately follow the sharp sign S. That's because this is explicitly, the syntax for this is explicitly stated in the description of the sharp sign S reader macro. But in contrast, the sharp sign C reader macro for complex literals just says after the dispatch character and the sub character, an object is read. And that means, for example, whitespace has to be allowed, comments have to be allowed, reader conditionals have to be allowed, and read time evaluation also has to be allowed. By the way, this is the same interpretation that SBCL takes. So one reason is it's specified like that, so differently for these two macros, but it's also what other implementations do. Here's another, this one's maybe more controversial. So Eclector thinks you can't have unquote in the reader macro for the function special operator. I won't discuss this further, but that's at least the interpretation I could get from the specification. Here's the project size. So as you can see, it's a at most medium-sized project, maybe small even. But noteworthy, there's almost as much test code as actual code. And therefore, Eclector is very close to 100% coverage and even branch coverage. Of course, there are still bugs, mostly from not getting to implementing some part of the specification or interpreting the specification incorrectly. But as far as I know, there have been no regressions so far. So when making changes, I'm very confident that I don't introduce new behavior accidentally. But again, this is, of course, an approach that only makes sense when implementing a specification. Otherwise, going for this kind of test coverage wouldn't make too much sense. And finally, the documentation is techinfo based and will in the future use this homegrown syntax highlighting that you see here. So briefly, what the documentation looks like at the moment is a HTML version, PDF and GNU. All of those are thanks to techinfo, and the HTML, HTML version is like this, and currently mostly covers is mostly reference documentation and a few specialized topics such as error recovery. Okay. Eclector is already used by several clients. The SQL Common Lisp implementation that I mentioned uses it as its Common Lisp reader. Similarly, the CLASP implementation. There's also a Common Lisp Jupyter that uses Eclector for reading code and providing completion, maybe also validation to the user, I'm not sure. There's Grammatex, Software Evolution Library, and an S-Expression diff utility. I'm not sure whether that's the same software or not. In any case, they use Eclector to construct syntax trees. There's Shinmara's Staple Documentation System. This uses Eclector and a little bit of S-Expression parsing on top for highlighting and cross-referencing source snippets. And as a future client, there's also Second Climax, which will use Eclector as the first stage of more or less a static analysis pipeline, which will cover highlighting, syntax checking, and, yeah, as I said, further static analysis, even invoking parts of the SQL compiler. The common theme here is, as you may have noticed, that it would in all cases be useful to have something like eclector as a follow-up, but at the S expression syntax level. So for turning the output of eclector into abstract syntax trees, more on that later. So yeah, it would be good to have such a library in the future. Okay, now the first feature that I wanted to discuss, errors and error recovery. So at the character level, there are many possible ways of violating the supposedly simple Common Lisp syntax. So the uniformity and simplicity is probably more at the S expression level, would be my take on that. So here are a few examples. A classical one, of course, is missing parentheses at the end of input or within expression. Here's an invalid way to spell a symbol, can't have two package markers. This may not be wrong in every single implementation, but at least when only using standard characters, this is an invalid character name. Here's an invalid digit in the specified base 10. And in this case, the unquote must be followed by an object, as the error message says. To produce this kind of good error messages, eclector considers all the possible errors explicitly and detects them at the appropriate location, signals a specialized condition for each particular error. So there are lots of exported conditions, and as you can see, they describe very specific situations. All in all, there are currently around 100 situations and corresponding conditions that can be detected and reported. The other part of error handling is recovering from errors. This is unusual for Common Lisp readers, but it is important for applications like editors, integrated development environments, syntax checkers, or static analyzers, for which one strategy would always be to stop analyzing a top-level form if there's an error in it. But it is, of course, better to continue reading and then execute later stages, such as S expression-based analysis, or even later stages. And things like syntax checkers or static analyzers may even work in some kind of batch mode, and then it's, of course, impossible to just fix the error and continue. So here is an example of recovering from errors within a single form or a single top-level form. So you can see, first of all, the form has been passed. Everything is highlighted more or less correctly. So that means the reader did finish despite the errors. And then in this case, the errors are also annotated, as for example here, for a binary number, this is not a valid digit, of course. Again, an invalid character name. This is from a different layer, but maybe also funny. So this complaints with the warning, not an error, because there's a tab in there. Another one with unquote, because there's no backquote around that. This is again from the more style-based layer. So this says, as you can see, don't use unexported symbols. And this reference is an undefined label. And finally, for good measure, the closing parenthesis is missing at the end. This kind of recovery doesn't happen automatically, of course, because then you wouldn't detect errors or wouldn't receive conditions for errors as you are used to. So as an option, the recover restart and also a convenience function of the same name are provided so that clients can recover if they want to. So the simplest way of making a recovering reader is just binding a handler for errors that invokes the recover function. Similarly, how you could bind a handler using the commonlisp continue function. And then despite multiple errors in this input, an output is produced, whether this is valid or usable, or even the best possible repaired output for this input is not something Eclecto will make any guarantees. So the objective is finishing reading, not producing some kind of magically repaired answer. Here's a slightly more elaborate example. So this still behaves like the previous example by calling recover, but it also prints the restart description, which is a description of the recovery strategy. And it also prints the error condition, just to give an impression how this how those two look and how this fits together. So the three problems here are the invalid token, so the error condition mentions that, and the restart description describes how to recover from it. And similarly for the missing object after unquote, which is replaced with nil, or a nil is injected maybe, and also the closing parenthesis, which is just added as well as if the list had been closed there. Okay, I said one goal was also to make the error conditions and other messages translatable. This is the job in the context of the SICKL project, or the S-expressionists cabal, if you want to call it that, the job of the acclimation library. So the difference to the previous example is that we make an instance of the acclimation language and bind the acclimation variable locale to a locale containing that language. And as you can see, as a result, this part here is translated, but everything else uses translated versions of the Eclector error messages and restart descriptions. I mean, this is of course a joke. Not even a German person would like to read Antizitat and things like that. Yeah, at this point, I would conclude the discussion of the error and error recovery features and show applications and demos based on this. Let me see. Okay, this is the first one. This just goes through an example here and annotates problems it has found. So we have seen this and this. But as you can see, there are also other kinds of annotations. In this case, based on remembering that there was a comment in the input and how it was spelled. Similarly here, this is based on white space around the object that a normal reader would consider. And also here, this is based on the exact spelling of the symbol. And similarly here, the reader conditional is also available for processing when using Eclector. The other thing is this one. This was more or less the batch demonstration. This is the interactive one. So this does basically the same, but for each key press. There were already good examples. So this says a sub character has to follow. I add the sub character, it says a digit has to follow, and then it's satisfied. But if I add the incorrect digit as before, it complains again. Same, for example, for a complex character. And maybe this gives you an impression of the amount of detail Eclecto tries to achieve. So it says that it's reading the imaginary part even. So if I add that, it says the list has to be closed. It has a specific error message in case there's an additional component in the complex number and so on. So Eclecto tries to have a specific error message for more or less everything. And here's a little preview that also illustrates Eclecto features. So this is from Eclecto. It can tell us that the form here is incomplete because of the missing parentheses. But here's a hint. So this is an invalid expression. So as you can see, this does a little bit of work on the S expression level. That's the preview part. And the Eclecto part is that even if I delete the closing parentheses, it can still say something about the function name. So if I make this a function name again, and maybe say, let's see, this, we are already missing two parentheses, but it can still say this is part of the lambda list and the number one cannot be a variable name. Okay, but I'm trying to not tease too much at this point. Let's see, anything else that's good? It can, for example, can report different kinds of unfinished delimited constructs, such as block comments or strings. Or structure literals. Okay, but in previous attempts, the presentation was too long already, so I'm just going to move on here. The next part is customizing ordinary reader features. That's where I complained about the specification that only the variables and the read table are customizable. Eclecto tries to do better, which leads to the first idea regarding the architecture. So all operations performed by the reader and also the parts of the reader algorithm and token interpretation are expressed as protocols, which means sets of generic functions, and each of those accepts a client parameter. That's a more or less design pattern that you probably know if you use any software provided by the S expressionists cabal. The reason is that if you see a generic function like this interpret token, which has this client parameter, then Eclecto only has to make sure that an object provided by the client is always passed as the first parameter. And if that is ensured, then the client can define its own methods on all of the generic functions that make up the behavior. So using this pattern, everything becomes customizable. And indeed, in Eclecto, as I said, the parts of the reader and also behavior of the standard reader macros are customizable on a very fine granularity using this technique. This shows the architecture on a larger scale and provides a bit of context for how this design pattern is used in Eclecto. So one goal was to provide a conforming reader implementation. This is basically here. The entry points, read preserving white space, and so on, that you would get in any conforming implementation. And accordingly, a client can just use this interface and get standard behavior as with any other reader. The second way to use this is binding the client variable before calling any of these entry point functions, and binding this client variable to an instance of a particular class will allow customizing the behavior down here. So there's a kind of middle part where the reader algorithm high-level loop and high-level behavior is implemented. This is also customizable, but the point is this client object is passed through all layers and, for example, ends up in interpret symbol token, making this function customizable for the client. Similarly, for example, for evaluate expression, which is invoked not as part of the core reader algorithm, but by the corresponding standard reader macro, so hash dot in this case. To demonstrate this, I would like to give an example that is apparently the most interesting use case for Eclector for many people. And that is making a sandboxed reader. To illustrate this a little bit before I go to the practical part of this, here are three threads and corresponding extension points that can be used to mitigate the respective thread. The first one is read time evaluation, which of course would allow for untrusted input the attacker, in quotes, to execute arbitrary code. This can be mitigated using Eclector's evaluate expression generic function. Structure constructors can also execute arbitrary code. There's make structure instance to customize this behavior. And finally, uncontrolled interning is not directly an attack, but it can be used to perform unwanted changes in the Lisp image. There's a whole family of generic functions for controlling this, but we will focus on interpret symbol. So at this point, I switch to this. So first, as I said, we need a new client. So in this case, we make a sandboxed client. And for convenience, a new function that reads from a string using this using this client. Okay, that works. And here we need read from string. So as I said, when explaining the high-level entry points, we call this like an ordinary reader, but the difference is that we bind the client variable around the call. Okay, so the first thread was the read time evaluation. So demonstrating this using the SPCL reader. Sorry, that's a bit confusing. Okay, so still wrong. What I wanted to write is this. Okay, there's the error. Now we can change this. But before we try this, we have to provide the actual mitigation. So we use our client as specializer, and then return the provided expression evaluation into a harmless uninterpreted datum. So doing this gives us this result but doesn't evaluate anything. Okay, the next one would be something like this, a structure that has side effects when constructed, and with the ordinary reader we get this. Now our mitigation make structure instance is this, and we get the name and a list of init args, and using the same strategy we can turn this into an uninterpreted datum. Of course. And in this case, using our safe read, we just get the information for the structure, but no attempt is made to actually construct the structure. Okay, and finally, doing this with the ordinary reader, we'll just intern in the current package. We can prevent this by defining a method on interpret token. This takes several arguments, and yeah, for demonstration purposes, we will just do the same thing again. And now with our safe read, we get the symbol, but with its name as a string and not interned. These of course compose with the built-in reader macros and so on, so this is not a problem using this with other constructs that the reader supports. Okay, moving on before this takes too long. That was the sandboxed reader demo. The next feature is handling of skipped input and lower level entry points. The architectural idea here is to notify the client when non-objects are encountered, which is unavoidable because according to the reader algorithm, the reader has to skip over certain things like white space or conditionalized input or comments. So that can't be avoided, but the client can be notified, and Eclector can also provide an interface to smaller parts of the reader algorithm that do not automatically skip over things. So for the notification part, there's the generic function NoteSkippedInput that will be called from within the reader algorithm, and then breaking the algorithm into smaller pieces are, for example, these call as top level read, surrounds a non recursive call of the reader algorithm, and this read maybe nothing performs one iteration of the reader loop. This can be seen in a second version of this diagram. The entry and client-facing interface here is still the same, but we focus on a different part of the reader algorithm. So the call as top-level read mentioned before here wraps around the rest of the reader algorithm and establishes things like, for example, the ability to track references with sharp sign equals. This read common here is the main loop, which skips over non-objects by repeatedly calling read maybe nothing. And let's say this encounters white space, then it will call node skipped input, so the client will know that. Same for comments or conditionalized parts of the input. This read maybe nothing will in its return value, for example, indicate that it encountered white space. The reader algorithm loop here will ignore this, but the client is notified, and calling read maybe nothing directly, of course, also allows handling these lower level input objects. For objects, in contrast to skippable input, let's say a reader macro, for example, a recursive call to read and then read common, and everything else here will be made. And in this case, let's say the reader macro returned something, then read maybe nothing indicates that an object was read and the object is returned. And at this level, only the object is visible, not anything that happened before that. So this ability to explicitly retrieve input that is normally skipped is of course used in the syntax highlighting that that you probably have seen throughout the demonstration. So for example, for an input like this, which could appear in HTML like this, maybe with some tag around it, Eclector will see this comment and highlight it as a comment. It will repair the missing parentheses, then highlight things accordingly. So as I said, this is used in this presentation and will soon be used in the Eclector manual. Can show this a little bit more. I'm confusing myself. Like this, for example, this will just attach a CSS class to all parts of the input. I think this is some GNOME thing. Let's see, let's do this. So we get a number and number for the parts. We get a number for the whole thing. For lists, we get this nesting thing, which helps on the CSS level to do this parenthesis matching or delimiter matching. It's actually also used for strings. Yeah, but I guess that's enough about that. The message is that we have access to parts like comments and other parts that would normally be skipped. Okay, now reader conditionals are of course also of this kind of thing that is normally skipped. And I would like to demonstrate this a little bit as well. So if I can find it, yes, okay. So this reads, in this case, some part of the SBCL code base and looks at the explicitly represented reader conditionals and does some logic-based checks. So in this case, you can see that this code is conditional on the immobile code feature. And then this, which is in the same top-level form, repeats this conditional, which, as it says, is then redundant in this context. It's also possible to have unsatisfiable reader conditionals, for example, here, where This cannot possibly be XCL, there's no need to check this. And there are also, of course, totally obvious ones like this. But in this case, it is, of course, done on purpose. So to be fair, no oversight or error has been detected in this case. Okay, really quickly, as the final demo in this section, this also read some part of the SPCL code base and constructed a tree of the, let's say, effective reader conditionals at some point. And it can then highlight the locations where those occurred. So for example, here is the context, and then there are two conditionals. Or for this combination, there are four places, and they are shown here. Don't know whether there's anything interesting, but you get the idea. So it is possible to process parts of the input that are normally not available to portable programs with the eClector. Moving on to the category of path results. First, I would briefly, more or less independently of eClector, introduce the notions of concrete syntax tree and abstract syntax tree. So assuming in a C-like language, we would pass this kind of input, a concrete syntax tree is normally very closely related to the path tree. So it contains, for example, tokens of the input, such as the opening parenthesis here, such as the comment. And the, for in case of this multiplication, also the token that is the operator here. And also source locations often as hinted here. In contrast, an abstract syntax tree discards, or the construction of an abstract syntax tree discards anything that is not relevant for the semantics of the program. So things like comments or parentheses are not needed anymore after encoding the operator precedence in the tree structure. So all of this gets thrown away. And at least traditionally, abstract syntax trees also don't contain directly source information. So that's the kind of abstraction from the concrete input tokens. In eClector, we don't do either of those, at least not directly, but we are closer to concrete syntax trees if we want to. But the difference is here the grammar of the language knows, for example, something about operator precedence and makes a more sophisticated tree structure out of this, while in Common Lisp and thus also when eClector reads something, this level is already too high. So eClector will always only produce a structure out of consists and atoms without considering the meaning at the S expression or higher levels. So this is just a little bit of background. But still, path results, which can be made into trees and also source locations, as we saw in the previous general examples, are also useful for Lisp, with the slight difference I mentioned. So the third idea for eClector's architecture is that it should provide a way to make nodes, inner nodes and leaves for such a tree, which we can maybe call concrete syntax tree despite the differences, and also associated source locations. The protocol for this is not very complicated, as you can see. So the client has to provide a way to retrieve a source location, or there's also a default way, but the client can provide its own source positions. And then there are methods for making path results, one for object results and one for non-object results. The responsibility is shared here. The client is responsible for making the result objects, while Eclector takes care of the tree structure by telling the client which children should be below a node being constructed. Here's again a picture of the architecture. I think I forgot to mention that the path result based interface is in a separate package. So this is not the eclector.reader package anymore. And similarly here, this is the path result based interface, and there's no way to omit the client parameter for this interface, because the client has to customize certain aspects when using this. But after that, the core of the reader still operates in the same way, and of course also shares code between the path result and ordinary behavior. So the call as top level read, read common, and maybe read nothing still happen. But in this case, if the client used this interface and provided a suitable client object, the reader algorithm will also call the path result construction functions, such as make skipped input, which makes a suitable result, that's the client's choice, for representing skipped input, and for objects within, well, in this case directly for objects, make expression result is used, which produces a path result, but also for recursive calls here. And then this path result goes through the normal reader algorithm as an additional return value. And at the interface level, it is even the primary return value. We can briefly look at this here. Like this, for example. So this is another thin layer above the path result protocol that connects the path result construction to the concrete syntax tree library, which is also a product of the S-expressionists cabal. To relate this to the previously discussed topic, the concrete syntax tree library is one way, one particular way of making syntax trees. And this Eclector system provides basically an adapter that does this automatically. So briefly looking at this, the path result is an object that has the source information, in this case from the beginning to the end of the input, and it also has the object that an ordinary reader would have returned, so the list in this case. And this const result has a first and rest slot, where the first slot in this case has an atom result, which represents an actual atom, and the corresponding source location from the second to the third character of the input. And here we can go down the tail of the list until we get to the atom result for nil. And This is maybe noteworthy. This atom result for nil doesn't have a source location because it's not explicit in the input. Similarly, for the multiple tail lists here, those also don't have source locations at the moment because they are not explicit in the input. In contrast, the other atoms have the appropriate source locations. Okay. Oh, sorry. Okay. This is where I wanted to end up. So two more demonstrations highlighting path results and their applications. The first one, very quickly, is this. So this looks at a source code file, and based on path results, can look at the spelling of symbols as opposed to just the package. As opposed to just the package and the symbol name. So in this case, the symbol, we can see this here. So it says the symbol that is actually in the CLIM package and called make ellipse star is spelled as this CLIM internals package with double package marker. So this is more complicated than necessary. And if we look at this, sure enough, this is the actual name of the symbol. So we could use this to improve the code like this. Okay, and finally, the parser thingy. I think I prepared that here. So since we know the difference between concrete and abstract syntax trees, I can demonstrate this briefly. So this is a more or less abstract syntax tree for Python, but with source locations attached. And it is updated as I type, as you can see. So just to explain how this visualization works, doing this for Eclector. As I said, this is a bit different because the produced trees will have fewer semantic annotations. This is also without error recovery, as you can see. But we are looking at the path results. So this doesn't say what the result means, just that it is a const result with children for the atoms. What else can we do? Complex are always good examples. Maybe some array. Eclector can also do quasi quotation, of course. And something like this is detected. But this is not detected. Daniel told me that this is actually unspecified. So I will have to look into this later. But I think this is sufficient for making the tree structure evident, and also how it basically stays at the lower syntactic level without any interpretation. Okay, so that concludes the path result category and the demonstrations as well. Before I conclude, a little bit about performance. So here's an example that consists in reading a small but complex in terms of reader features used expression. And as you probably have guessed, this is SPCL's reader and this is Eclector. So it's not terrible, but also not great in terms of performance. but you have to keep in mind that SBCL's reader is very heavily optimized and can also avoid allocating on the heap, as you can see, by the amount of const temporary data. In Eclector's case, there should be some low-hanging fruit. For example, this big chunk here is related to fixing up the result after reading. Fixing up in this case means going through the returned result and looking for references with sharp sign and a number that have to be substituted. And also, if you can see this, this little green thing here is in many places and combined, those take up a good chunk of the processing time. This is the syntax type generic function. And in the current implementation, this uses a hash table to find the syntax type of each and every character. So you can imagine these hash table lookups, they add up. For future work, one thing is the construction of floating point numbers. Eclector currently uses this rather naive algorithm to do it. This is bad in terms of performance. There are much better algorithms for this, and it's also possibly not optimal in terms of the precision of the constructed result, depending on what this does in a given implementation. So to rectify this, we could use a better algorithm, but we could also allow the client to, or maybe just dump the responsibility onto the client by defining a new protocol function, or we could do both, improve the default behavior but still allow the client to implement its own preferred way to do this. There's the handling of symbols and packages, and to show why this is a problem, let me go back to this. So I did this example in a particular order because if I hadn't done the symbol interpretation last, we would have gotten this. So our own symbol representation cannot designate a structure type, and to allow custom symbol interpretation and still operate and still interoperate with the rest of the system, maybe a protocol like this could be used. There are other things like reader extensions, which, for example, SBCL has for reading a form in a different package than the current package, a rational syntax for floats, maybe 1,000 separators in numbers would be nice, or in integers at least. And of course, hash tables, hash table literals, everyone makes one. There are extensions for Unicode character names, and basically there's lots that could be done. It would also be good to have multi-column error locations instead of only highlighting only one character in errors. Quasi-quotation could be made extensible, for example, to work with the custom hash tables. Performance can be improved. Maybe the org export of common Lisp code could benefit from Eclector-based highlighting. But there are lots of ideas and only so much time. So at this point, I say thank you for your attention. On this slide are some resources for Eclector. Most interactive discussion happens in the SICL channel on the IRC network. The Eclector code can be found on GitHub in the S Expressionists Cabal organization, and the documentation is also online next to the source code repository. So let me thank you again, and this concludes my presentation.